You guys can read. You see the title. You know what it's about. Let's get it over with so I can go back to bashing my head against the wall. Hey everyone, it's the Koopa Man. And it's time for the question of the day. Why the fuck would you remake or adapt something if you have no intent to respect the source material or its fans? For context, last October, at a PlayStation Direct, if I recall correctly, it was announced that there was gonna be a remake of the hit psychological horror game, Silent Hill 2. Only one small problem. No, not just PlayStation exclusive, thus subject to Sony's so anti-Japanese standards and censorship they make the FDR administration blush, is that this remake wouldn't be done by Team Silent, the original creators of Silent Hill. This shouldn't be all that surprising, as Team Silent kind of has a spotty record after the last few entries in the series, but it did raise some red flags for people. The team they got instead is Bloober Team, a relatively new developer who had not long ago made a VR Blair Witch Project game that got average to above average reviews. But as the old saying goes, 'tis better to be silent and thought a fool than to open your mouth and remove all doubt. If you can imagine, it didn't take long for the new developers to make complete jackasses of themselves. Let's have a read of what they said, shall we? Instead of remaking Silent Hill 2 faithfully, the team has decided that they want to recreate their perfect memory of it. According to Peter Babieno, this also gave them the opportunity to do certain things differently and smuggle in some vision of ours. Skipping ahead a little bit. The pre-existing story was adapted into their game with changes to the script, dialogue, new subplots, and alternate endings implemented to bring it closer to their vision. And here comes the aneurysm. Thanks, Bloober. Now, this is a project that's not out yet, and the source for the quote was the Silent Hill fandom wiki, which anyone can edit. Time will tell if it proves to be true or if it's a warning of what's to come. The reason I bring it up, however, is this is far from the first time that something like this has happened. As of late, there has been issues with a newer generation of, quote, visionaries coming in to remake, continue, or adapt other works, but insert their own bullshit to make it all about themselves, thus ruining these stories. It comes off as the mass media equivalent of that one woman who fixed that painting of Jesus Christ a few years back. And if I recall correctly, the same kinds of people who defended these reimagined adaptations defended that painting as well. Of course, these are mostly godless heathens we're talking about, but I digress. One such example of these acts of vandalism is, well, everything to do with The Last of Us recently, both its sequel, its remake, and its HBO adaptation. After the success of Uncharted 2 Among Thieves, Naughty Dog were out to make a new title and would split the team that made Uncharted 2 into two halves, one to work on Uncharted 3, and the other to work on this new game. This game would become The Last of Us, and was headed up by Bruce Straley with Neil Druckmann, a notorious man-bun, co-directing. The game ended up being incredibly successful, due in no small part to Straley's direction and Amy Hennig's uncredited supervision, as she was on paper working only on Uncharted 3, but actually provided aid for both projects. Just a side note, I don't actually like The Last of Us at all, but I can respect the work that Craig and Amy did. Just isn't my thing. Mainly for what those two didn't do, and it's very obvious who did what. For example, when the first DLC was released, instead of focusing on the world and lore of The Last of Us, well, it kind of did explain Ellie's immunity to the zombie mushrooms, but that was kind of a hand wave. It instead focused on the character Ellie's, an underage girl's, lesbian sexuality. Yeah, the DLC was primarily directed by the Man Bun. Then it came time for the sequel, so Neil Man Bun, high off his own farts, took charge and had Amy Hennig and Bruce Straley pushed out of the company so nothing would get between him and his, quote, vision. And from that, we got The Last of Us Part 2, which was, well, an absolute train wreck. Cringy dialogue, forced politics, transsexuals and lesbians in the post-apocalypse where it makes no sense, the murder and mutilation of characters that the fans in the previous title loved, to prop up a new Mary Sue that the Man Bun self-insert was sure to have a sex scene with, and oh right, mo-capped underage lesbian sex scenes. Yeah, it was a mess. But I'm not here to repeat what's already been said, only to use this franchise to make my grander point. To say it was a shoddy sequel is putting it lightly. In fact, it's one of the worst sequels ever made, in most people's definitions at least. Up there with the Star Wars sequels, which character-shelled Rey to no end and included a lot of political dogshit of its own, as well as bad writing and unlikable characters. Terminator Dark Fate, which killed the franchise's chosen one, John Connor, to prop up a girl power message. Ralph Breaks the Internet, which ignored the previous movie's moral to push a very forced cliché storyline full of bad jokes and blatant company shilling, and the fact that it's a blatant ripoff of the Emoji Movie. Toy Story 4, which took a diarrhea dump on the ending of the Toy Story trilogy so Woody can abandon his kid and be with an abusive partner. Incredibles 2, which wasted its story and lore to be mostly a cliché retread of the first movie, just swapping Helen with Bob. Or any number of bad propagandistic sequels I haven't personally had the displeasure of viewing, such as Wolfenstein The New Colossus and New Blood, James Bond No Time to Die, The Matrix Resurrections, the new Indiana Jones movie, HBO's Watchmen sequel series, or the Proud Family revival series. And let's not forget to mention the God of War sequels. None of these sequels, least of all Last of Us 2, were good sequels. They didn't respect the works that came directly before it, they didn't respect the characters, they didn't respect the fans of those games, TV shows, and movies, and least of all, they didn't respect the original creators. In the case of Last of Us Part 2, Neil had the original creators kicked out of Naughty Dog just so he could take full control of the ship, and it shows. The man is a case of egomania wearing a man bun. But that's just sequels. But what about remakes and reboots, which are just remakes with an asterisk? Let us go back to The Last of Us. After the critical success, but fan rejection, of Last of Us Part 2, Neil Manbun decided to remake The Last of Us. Which not only was not necessary, but when it came out, it was a glorified remaster that they couldn't have possibly remade from the ground up. All it was the same game with the same mechanics, well, mostly the same mechanics, the DLC included in the package, some female characters made uglier to avert the male gaze, just a reminder that Manbun had Amy Hennig, a woman veteran in the gaming industry, pushed out of her own company, and a few lines changed here and there to keep the narrative consistent with The Last of Us Part 2. Oh, and top it all off, Manbun had Bruce Straley removed from the credits. In spite of all this, as far as remakes go, this is the least bad we've seen as of late. The characters remained largely the same, the plot remained the same, they even did a few minor mechanical fixes that made the game flow better. Granted, the PC port was a disaster, but that's a different problem with nothing to do with remakes. Honestly, considering it was headed up by Neil Manbun and the way remakes were sanitizing the originals at the time, it could have been a lot worse. Take for example Disney's quote live-action remake of The Lion King, a pointless shot-for-shot remake that, while it doesn't stray too far from the source material, still misses the point of every shot. I mean, look at the movie's opening. Here's the original. And here's the remake. Did you notice? I'll break it down. Not only does the remake stall on the scenery before the sunrise begins, they didn't even bother to center it in the shot. That moment was the thing that, for the original, Disney decided to use as the opening scene of the movie, as well as the opening for the trailer, the thing that got people excited to see the movie to begin with. That shot is the thing that made the original the best-selling animated movie of all time, and I will fight anyone who says otherwise. Even going further into the Circle of Life sequence, you see misplaced shots like these, as well as the animals looking like they came out of a low-rent Chinese knockoff of a JRPG game. They even re-recorded the main vocals with a new singer while keeping the original chanting from archival recordings, and it can't be for the same reasons they recast the main cast, as the original singer was also black. This is a common problem with the Disney live-action remakes. Many of them make pointless changes for the sake of chasing a social agenda, while a lot of the charm and magic of the originals is lost, as you just cannot do the same things in live-action that you can do with animation. Or with CGI with the case of The Lion King. This was also the main problem with The Little Mermaid, Cinderella, Beauty and the Beast, and Aladdin as well. And of course, Last of Us has a live-action adaptation too, with all the same problems. Especially with the man bun. For more information on that, I would recommend going to watch Almighty Lolly's video on it. And remember, EFAP and Critical Drinker defended it. Then there's stuff like Netflix's adaptations of Cowboy Bebop, which wears the original source material like a skin while watering down and sanitizing it to suit the Hollywood agenda so that it no longer has any soul, or Netflix's adaptation of Death Note, which is basically an in-name-only adaptation that barely pays any tribute to the source material and may as well be its own work. And it still sucks. With a track record like that, tourists wonder why I'm skeptical about their new god, the Netflix One Piece adaptation, and about the legitimacy of anyone currently praising it. While on the topic of death flicks, however, there is also things like Maleficent, which retells the story of Sleeping Beauty from the villain's perspective with a sympathetic light shown on the mistress of all evil. Also the same for Cruella de Vil in, well, Cruella de Vil, the woman who kills puppies. But rewriting villains to be sympathetic is a topic enough for its own video. Stay tuned. My main point right now being, if you can't even keep the moralities of the characters from the original correct, why are you even remaking or adapting the works in the first place? Why are you even adapting it is a question that can also be asked of Ninja Theory, who did the reboot of Devil May Cry, which had its directors say the female characters Lady and Trish were sexist, while he made one of the game's bosses a floating allegory of Bill O'Reilly, and one of the main characters, Virgil, kill a pregnant demon. Yeah, DMC Devil May Cry is not good. Neither is the 2016 Ghostbusters reboot, which exists to emasculate the old cast and the original movie's fans, for the purposes of adding queef jokes and a sassy black woman stereotype, which considering the original character Winston Zeddemore was very much not a racial stereotype, says more about the creators of the reboot than anything. It's like the creators of these remakes, sequels, reboots, and adaptations just hate the source material, which, funny enough, we actually have it on record that The Last Jedi's director not only hated Star Wars, but wanted to one day destroy a franchise. And the director of the He-Man reboot, Kevin Smith, also expressed not only not being a fan of He-Man, but outright hating it before he was given that project. Is it not enough to just not like something and leave it at that? Why must these creators go out of their way to tear down these works and their fans for even existing? And why is it so easy to make references to Razorfist by asking these questions? That's the crux of it with these sequels, remakes, reboots, and adaptations. You gotta care about what you're adapting, or it'll come off stupid at best or malicious at worst. That doesn't mean you gotta be one-to-one accurate all the time with what you're remaking. Remember, not everything works in every medium. For example, you have Stanley Kubrick's adaptation of The Shining, which made changes from the original novel, which, in spite of Stephen King's protest, made it work as a movie. When King went to make a faithful adaptation as a made-for-TV miniseries, it didn't pan out nearly as well. Oh, and before I forget, it's probably a good idea that they cut out the child sex scene out of Stephen King's It in both adaptations. Yeah, knocked that moral pedestal right out from under him. Then there's stuff like Jaws, which I just made a movie on, and Jurassic Park, both of which had characterization slightly altered to expand motives and to make characters more likable. Sometimes the adaptation is so good it even outshines the original source material, such as with The Godfather, where even the book's original author, Mario Puzo, agrees that the movie duology is the better version. And no, I'm not gonna talk about The Godfather Part 3. Sequels as well need to be faithful to the story and characters that existed so far. That's why people love the King of Fighters franchise and were so angry at Guilty Gear Strive. The former being capable of having larger than life and lovable characters who stay consistent with their heart and soul, even passing director to director over 15 games, and the latter throwing away all its story and character motivations to chase a social agenda. Even when a sequel moves from one main character to another, it's gotta be done respectfully. Take for example Metal Gear Solid 2. While some would argue changing the protagonist from Snake was a mistake, others would argue that it was the entire point of the story and putting Snake in a mentor role actually makes him more badass. There's a similar scene as well in Yakuza Like a Dragon where the former protagonist, Kazuma Kiryu, gives support to the new protagonist, Ichiban Kasuga. Or in Batman Beyond where Bruce Wayne, now old and arthritic, passes his suit to train a younger Terry McGinnis when he sees the boy is a lot like him, having lost his father to criminals and wanting revenge. This way, Bruce can mentor the next generation of Gotham that still needs a Batman, while also keeping Terry from a much darker path. It's all a matter of respect. Respect for the original authors, respect for the characters, respect for the stories, and respect for the fans. Respect is the one thing that the current generation of creators is sorely lacking. Despite outward appearances of tolerance and acceptance and virtue, many of today's creative types are the biggest narcissists to ever walk this earth. As such, they wouldn't understand respect if it came up and bit them in the ass. They believe that it's an entitlement, not something that needs to be earned, and thus they hold no respect for anything outside of themselves or their own interests. That's the main reason why all these works are the way they are. And until they either learn to respect others outside of their own egos and inner circles, things won't improve. But the thing about narcissistic people like that is eventually they push all others away due to their own toxicity. One way or another, people are always humbled before God. And it's after that they either start to improve or they are pushed by the wayside. Hopefully the newer generation are more respectful than the current ones. Just be sure to teach these values that are sorely lacking, and maybe one day we'll start to see things improve. Until then, it's been the Koopa Man. Game on.